We were dealing yesterday with absolute, not absolute value, we were dealing with reciprocals of functions. This was a continuation of what we did from the previous day. The only difference was the previous day we were looking at, I want to show this to you graphically first. The previous day we were looking at reciprocals of linear functions, and we discovered, I'm not going to go through all of the details, but we discovered that when you have a linear function, if you graph y equals the reciprocal of that, it doesn't matter what this function is. If you were to graph y equals the reciprocal of that function, then it will have some features that are connected to the features of this graph. One of the features is that wherever there's an x-intercept, you are going to get a vertical asymptote. One of the features is regardless of what the original function looks like. In this course, the x-axis will always be a horizontal asymptote. One of the features is that wherever y is equal to 1 or y is equal to negative 1, you're going to have what are called invariant points. So you have asymptotes, you have invariant points. The final thing that you need to look at is you have to draw curves that are doing the opposite compared to what the original function is doing. So in this region here, the original function is increasing when you go left to right. So in that region, what you draw has to be decreasing as you go left to right. It also has to be asymptotic to those asymptotes. That just means that it has to get closer and closer to the asymptotes in all directions. And that means, oh, great. That's nice. That means that pretty much the only thing you can draw in here is something that looks like that. And here is something that looks like that. Because whatever you draw has to be decreasing from left to right because the function is increasing. And that's what it looked like the day before yesterday. There were some other details to that, but yesterday we looked at what happens if you have a quadratic function. And what we learned is the same ideas are still going to hold true. You're going to have vertical asymptotes wherever there's an x-intercept. By the way, maybe one of the most important things out of all of this from both days, I forgot to mention, what's going on when you go from f of x, from a graph of y equals f of x, to a graph of y equals 1 over f of x, is that any ordered pair on the original function becomes this for an ordered pair on the reciprocal function. So you're always taking the reciprocal of the y coordinate, which is why x-intercepts turn into vertical asymptotes, because the y coordinate will just take this x-intercept here of negative 4, that's at negative 4 comma 0, it has to change into negative 4 comma 1 over 0. And you can't divide 1 by 0. You can't divide anything by 0. So it's not allowed. You would have, gonna have to reboot my computer, I think. You would have a horizontal asymptote there. I'm gonna risk this and see if I can blow this up. It's probably really gonna lock my computer down. Nope. You're going to have an invariant point here because y is 1 and the reciprocal of 1 is 1. You're going to have an invariant point here for the same reason. You're going to have an invariant point. Here because y is negative 1 and the reciprocal of negative 1 is negative 1 and you'll have an invariant point there. Up top, you're going to have this feature as part of the graph and this feature. This has to come down through the invariant point and be asymptotic, with the vertical asymptote. And then you have to figure out how high to draw that hump, that hill. And what you can do is take the lowest point, which is at negative 2, comma, negative 4, and it's going to become negative 2, comma, 1 over negative 4, because that's what you do. You reciprocate the y-coordinate. That's negative 0.25, so this point here is going to end up being here, so your graph will look something like that. Again, there are more twists and turns to all of this, but that's it in a nutshell. Take a look over your work, please. Does anybody have any questions you would like me to go over? Go ahead, Seamus. 5B? D. So we want to know the x-intercepts and the y-intercept of this function. So the first thing to note is it's a reciprocal of a quadratic function. And whenever you have, basically this is what it boils down to, whenever you have 1 over a function, which is everything that we're dealing with in this section, you're going to have a horizontal asymptote on the x-axis. So whatever this graph looks like, we're going to get a horizontal asymptote there. And that means that there will be no x-intercept. So, in fact, the answer to what are the x-intercepts for any of these functions is that there aren't any x-intercepts. Now, if you like, I want to delve in a little bit deeper here. Let's just talk about this function. Now, we want to be careful here because f of x is the reciprocal of another function. So I normally say the function is y equals 1 over f of x. It's not. Y equals 1 over some other function, but it really doesn't matter. Think of it this way. This is the original function, and this is the reciprocal function. I started off, not yesterday, but the day before, everybody, by saying the phrase reciprocal function doesn't mean anything. Unless, it doesn't mean anything specifically, unless I give you the function it's the reciprocal of, right? So a reciprocal function is the reciprocal of some other function. That other function is original. If we were to, Seamus or anybody else, if we were to factor this, it factors into x plus 3, x plus 4, and that means that this function would have x-intercepts of negative 3 and negative 4. So if I were to sketch this, let's get rid of this asymptote and just, I don't want to have to reboot my computer. I'm going to ignore that asymptote and just tell you that I'm going to go to a different page. I want to rescale this. We said negative 3 and negative... We said negative 3 and negative 4? Okay. Ignore that asymptote. I can't redraw it. Jeez. Let's do this. So over here at negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, there's an x-intercept, negative 4, there's an x-intercept, etc. And looking at the function x squared plus 7x plus 12, it's positive x squared, so it opens up. It's going to look like that. By the way, it's going to cross the y-axis at 12 because 12 is the constant. So on the original, the y-intercept is 0, 12, right? Okay. On the original, we have an x-intercept of negative 3, 0, and we have an x-intercept of negative 4, 0. So on the reciprocal, Remember, we go from x comma y to x comma 1 over y. So this y-intercept is going to become zero comma 1/12. In other words, the y-intercept of the reciprocal function is going to be the reciprocal of the y-intercept of the original function. Make sense? Question? Yeah. Because this factors into x plus 3, x plus 4. Okay, so the numbers in the factored form are positive, but when we find an x-intercept, and I know you get this, but I want to write it out anyway, we are solving this equation, which we learned, you let y equal 0 to find an x-intercept, which we have all learned, everybody, that what you do is you set each factor equal to 0, and I think this explanation is worthy of repeating it. The reason why we can say x plus 3 equals 0 is because if x plus 3 is 0, this thing is 0, and I don't care what x plus 4 is, because 0 times it will give me 0, making it true. In other words, the x-intercepts are the zeros of the factors, and the zeros of the factors are the opposite to the numbers in the factors. You're good now, right? Okay. So that's fine. So in other words, the y-intercept of a reciprocal function is the reciprocal of the y-intercept of the function that it's reciprocating, the original one. Over here, if we apply that rule, we're going to have negative 3, 1 over 0. So this point just ceases to exist. And if I had to explain this again, I wouldn't have used this idea, because you might be under the misapprehension that, well, okay, fine, that point ceases to exist. Maybe there's some other point that lands on the x-axis somewhere. But that can't be the case, because there's no number. There's no number you can reciprocate to get 0. You know, the y-coordinate of an x-intercept is 0. What number? Maybe there's some other y-coordinate that if we take the reciprocal, it lands on the x-axis. Well, there isn't, because the reciprocal of any number will never give you 0. So, in other words, Seamus, the x-intercepts don't exist, and the y-intercept is simply the reciprocal of the y-intercept of the original function. So, for example, when you take a look now with that knowledge at C, the y-intercept of that reciprocal of that function, we don't need to put x equals 0 in, it's going to be 1 over negative 9. Because when you look only at this, this would have a y-intercept of negative 9, so the reciprocal of it is 1 over 9, negative 9. Does that make sense?
Kind of, yeah.
Okay. Two things to remember. Since a y-intercept is a y-value, when we go from a y-intercept of a function to the reciprocal function, that y-value for the y-intercept is just going to go 1 over to get a new y-intercept. And I'll get back to the x-intercepts in a second. It doesn't matter what the function looks like. You know, it could look like that. If this is 2, we've learned that to replot every point, you take this y-coordinate and you take the reciprocal, so it will be at 1/2. If this point happens to be at 1, then we take the reciprocal of 1, which will keep it to be 1, and we would reciprocate all of these numbers, so you're always reciprocating y. And I guess in the end, you know what, Seamus, the bottom line is reciprocal functions always have a horizontal asymptote on the x-axis, so they will never have an x-intercept. I hope that helps. Other questions? Any other questions? Okay, I want to go through a brief review here just to, I didn't prepare any kind of handout for this, for what I'm going to discuss, but I want to go through the topics that we studied because there are three areas in this unit. There are radicals, there are absolute values, and there are reciprocals. And it gets kind of confusing because with radicals, we did all the radical arithmetic and we did radical equations, but we never looked at radical graphs. With absolute value functions, we looked extensively at the graphs and we solved equations, but beyond that, we didn't do anything. With reciprocal, we didn't even do equations, we only looked at the graphs. So there's three main areas that we looked at in this unit. One I can just term to be radicals. And I'm just going to put up here what you're expected to know how to do. The first thing that you're expected to know how to do with radicals is multiply, divide, add, subtract radicals. And I'm not going to write down all of this information. And in fact, I don't expect some of you, I suspect, are just going to listen to this. You don't have to necessarily write it down either. You can, if that's your method of studying. You need to know that when you're multiplying radicals, you can only do it if they are the same index. You can multiply square roots and square roots and square roots, but you can't multiply square roots and cube roots and fourth roots. And the same goes with dividing. But in the end, multiplying and dividing involves multiplying coefficients by coefficients and radicands by radicands, and so does dividing. Even though we studied this next thing first, I'm putting it second because very often when you multiply or divide radicals, you have to do what number two is about. You need to be able to express radicals in simplest mixed form or as entire radicals in entire form. So you need to be able to take something like, and this is just the simplest elementary example, root 18 and write it as 3 root 2. You need to know how that works. And I say that's really the simplest I can get. I guess I could go root 8 would be even simpler, but the simplest I could get because that's only a square root and it doesn't even involve variables. So when you go back in your notes and you look at the first couple of lessons in this unit, and it was a long time ago we did it. We had cube root radicals, fourth root radicals, fifth root radicals. We had radicands, which are the things underneath the radical symbols that were variables as well. Okay, there was a lot going on there. Going back to adding and subtracting, remember that you can only add or subtract radicals if they are similar. What does that mean? It means they're all root twos or they're all root fives. You can take 6 root 2 minus 2 root 2. You can do that. It's 4 root 2. It's like, six monkeys minus two monkeys. You're going to have four monkeys. I don't know where the other two monkeys went, but we subtracted them. You're allowed to subtract or add radicals if the radicals are the same. You are not allowed to directly add or subtract something like 3 root 75 plus root 27. You can't do it. But you can simplify each of those and maybe end up with radicals that you can add or subtract together. For example, root 75 is root 25 root 3. Root 27 is root 9, root 3. How many of you see at this point why we're going to be able to add these together? They're going to contain root 3s. This is 5. Root 25 is 5. Root 9 is 3. So we have 15 root 3 plus 3 root 3, which is 18 root 3. Does anybody else smell coffee? Yes? A little bit? Okay, good. Not having some kind of stroke or something. You can smell it too. Okay, that's good. So, multiply, divide, add, subtract radicals, simplest mixed form to entire form. You need to be able to translate back and forth between the two. One of the things that gives many of you difficulties, so you're going to have to. Is that a bug? Wonder if he was trying to write something. That some of you struggle with, it's natural. At this level, for many students to struggle with this, is rationalizing denominators. And I'm not going to do examples here. I'm just going to provide a couple of examples to kind of maybe trigger your memory in this regard. If I had something like 8 over 6 root 2. Let's go 81 over 6 root 2. It doesn't really matter. We have a denominator that contains a radical. What you need to do here is multiply the top and the bottom of this expression, multiply the numerator and denominator of that expression by 2, root 2 rather. I wonder if I can erase. I'm going to go back to the 8 just because. When you multiply this out, you'll get 8 root 2 on the top and you'll get 12 on the bottom. And be very careful with skipping a step because I was so close to saying 24 on the bottom. I was going to say 24 because I thought 2 times 2 is 4, 4 times 6 is 24. But it's root 2 times root 2, which is 2. 2 times 6 is 12. Anyway, you will have eliminated the radical on the bottom. Don't multiply top and bottom of something like this by 6 root 2. You could multiply 6 root 2 over 6 root 2. It would still work. It's just that it would take you longer to get to the finish line. So I'm not finished here. I'm just showing you what you would do. The other one would be something like root 3 minus 1 over root 3 plus 2. And what you need to remember in this case is you multiply the numerator and the denominator by the conjugate of the denominator. You would have to FOIL out the top to see what happens. You would also, I guess, FOIL out the bottom, but you don't really need to FOIL out the bottom because your outer and inner will cancel. You'll just be left with 3 minus 2. Root 3 times root 3 is 3, minus root 2 times root 2 is 2. Well, that doesn't get much simpler than that. That's 1. Be careful though, because, and I forgot, oh, I didn't forget. I wrote a root down when I shouldn't have. It wasn't root 2, was it? It was just 2. So it wouldn't be 3 minus 2, it would be 3 minus 4. Root 3 times root 3 is 3. 2 times 2 is 4. It would be 3 minus 4, which is negative 1. The final thing you need to know how to do with radicals. So number 4 is to solve radical equations. And we've spent some time in this unit talking about how to solve equations graphically. It doesn't matter how many times I show you how to solve something graphically, you always need to know how to solve it algebraically. It's a good little written response question. Solve the following radical equation. I'm not going to write down these steps, but what you do is you isolate the radical, square both sides, solve the resulting equation, but then you need to remember to check to see if any of the answers that you get don't work. You have to check for what's called extraneous solutions. And you always go to the original equation. So that's radicals. You know, that could be a unit exam on its own. I would probably say this comprises at least half of the unit. Content-wise, exam-wise, etc. The next thing that we moved on to was absolute value. And one of the things that you're expected to do is evaluate absolute value expressions. This isn't a big deal on the exam, but you will see most likely some question like this where, for example, I might say, what is that equal to? And I didn't space this out very well. This is one set of absolute value signs. This is the other set of absolute value signs. You know, this is the absolute value of negative 12, and then we're subtracting the absolute value of negative 110, because negative 4 minus 8 is negative 12. Negative 10 minus 100 is negative 110. So we're taking 12 minus 110, which is negative, I think it's negative 98. You know, and there's a perfect example. I chose this as a quick illustration because sometimes people feel that when I say evaluate something and it's got an absolute value symbol somewhere in it, that your answer has to be positive. It can be negative. So you need to know how to evaluate absolute value expressions. The second thing we looked at is, well, I'm just going to say graphing. Well, I'll say graphing. I'll leave it at that first. And all that you need to remember there is that anything, and be very careful here, I'm talking absolute value, not reciprocal. And it's going to be easy for you to mix the two up. With absolute value functions, in order to graph the corresponding absolute value, you just graph the original function, and anything that's below the x-axis, you fold it up over top. Because that's what absolute value is. The absolute value of something that's negative, that's below the axis, is the negative of that to make it positive. And the negative of that flips it up. Connected to graphing, the third thing is you need to know how to write piecewise functions. Because I may just ask you how to write a piecewise function. But that leads into solving these equations. And I think number four is probably more memorable for you in terms of what we did in class than number three. Number four was where we were always taking the absolute value equation and ripping it apart into two equations, equation one and equation two. And each of those two equations had a subdomain. Equation 1 was typically found just by taking the original equation and getting rid of the absolute value signs because the argument was positive. Equation 2, you removed the absolute value signs and then multiplied the argument by negative 1, and that occurred in the subdomain where the argument was negative. So you multiplied it by negative to make it positive. Again, with these equations, you have to look for extraneous roots. The third thing, and I would say, I said the first thing counted for, radicals counted for at least half, let's say 55%. I would say that this counts for about 35%. And if you add up 55 and 35, you're at 90%. So the last 2 days, which deals with reciprocal functions, you know, it's not a. It is a big deal. You need to know how to do this stuff for the exam. You need to know how to do it for the final. You need to know how to work with it for next year. But really, all it boils down to is graphing y equals 1 over a linear, and y equals 1 over a quadratic. You know, I shouldn't just hand wave this away as if there's not much there. That includes finding equations of asymptotes, x and y intercepts of reciprocal functions, sketching them if you know the original function, finding the original function if you see the reciprocal function. There's more to it than just graphing it. I don't mean to just say, oh, you just graph it. You have to know how to graph it. So that's a quick review of the content or the main topics. I'm going to hand out a review package which has multiple choice and numerical response. Your exam is Monday. You guys know by now you get out of an exam what you decide to put into it before the exam, right? The more work you put in, the better you're going to do. So I'll hand that out. You can get to work on that. There are also the extra practice sheets at the end of the unit.